Morning, church family, and peace be with you. Would you please stand? Whether you are visiting with us or you're a member, we want to welcome you into the safety of this gathering where we can come as we are and enjoy the love of Christ together. Every time we gather, we respond to God's invitation to worship Him for who He is, to recognize His authority, and to give thanks for all that He's done for us. His word calls us to worship, saying, "The whole earth is filled with awe at your wonders. Where the morning dawns, where the evening fades, you call forth songs of joy." Let's read together. "You care for the land and water it. You enrich it abundantly. The streams of God are filled with water to provide the people with grain, for so you have ordained it. Praise awaits you, our God, in Zion. To you our vows will be fulfilled. You who answer prayer, to you all people will come." Amen, church. God is the giver of all good things, and He not only provides what we need for survival, but He also offers us Himself. And so with these things in mind, let's respond to His invitation to worship Him together.
When all is yours before, so poor. Oh, let your grace inspire my soul with strength divine. Let every word and each desire and all my days be yours.
Amen. Can we give him praise this morning? Amen.
Lord, And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. When we forget that God will provide us with what we need, we begin to well up with anxiety. We begin to hoard whatever we can. We become less generous to others. We try to control the people and the situations around us to ensure our own security. We're going to spend a few minutes in silent reflection and confession. Let's confess our lack of gratitude to God. Ask the Lord to remind you of all the ways that he has provided for you. Ask him to calm your anxiety and to make his perfect will known to you. Ask him to renew your trust in him. Let's pray.
To those who through the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ, have received a faith as precious as ours, grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. Amen, church. God is the provider of our daily bread, and he has given us Jesus, who is the bread of life, who sustains us and holds us day by day. And so because we have great confidence in him, we need not worry, even in the darkest of days, because we are covered in his mercy, we're covered in his provision, and we are covered in his divine power. And so because Jesus is risen and Jesus is reigning, let's worship him for the gift of salvation that we have received. Let's sing together. Thank you. not by the works.
It's not by the works of righteousness which our own hands have done, but we are saved by our Father's grace, abounding through His Son. But by the mercy of our God, all of our hopes begin, and by the water and the blood, our souls are washed, they're washed. But by the mercy of our God, all of our, that's where our hopes begin, and by the water and the blood, our souls are washed, they're washed, they're washed, our souls are.
By its mercy.
But by the mercy of our God, all of our hopes begin.
Saved by His blood.
And by the water and the blood, our souls are
in tenderness He sought me, so weak and sick with sin, and on His shoulder brought me into His flock again, while angels in His presence and sang until the courts of heaven rang. Oh, the love that sought me, oh, the blood that bought me, wondrous grace that brought me home to God. Mine. And and tell of his great love. Yet deeper, brighter, purer, I'll know these things above.
Eternal days.
It seems as if eternal days are far too short.
As we bask in the tender mercies of God our Father, and as we enjoy the peace He has given us in Jesus, let's take a few moments to greet one another in the peace of Christ.
Good morning. My name is Lindsay, and I'm on staff here at Sojourn East, and we are so glad that you're with us today. I have a few things to put before you, kind of mark your calendar so you know what's coming up here. First off, I want to let you know that next Sunday, we'll be having a meet and greet with our pastors and staff. This is an informal event we have pretty regularly, and this is a chance for those of you who are new, or maybe you've been coming for a little while and you're ready to kind of get to know a little bit more about the church. This is a chance for you to stop by. We'll have some refreshments. It's just, like I said, super informal. Come by, say hello, introduce yourself, let us get to know you, and you can get to know us a little bit more. So that'll be next Sunday after both services. We hope you'll stop by and say hello. Also next week marks the start of our men's and women's coordinated Bible studies. We're super excited. This semester we're going to be studying the first half of the book of Acts. And as you may know, the book of Acts kind of is a pivotal time in the history of the church as the church was going forward and the gospel was spreading. And so men and women together are going to be studying the book of Acts. Women will be meeting on Monday evenings and Wednesday mornings, and our men will be meeting bright and early Wednesday morning. And so a registration is required for that event. So we hope that you will kind of look at your schedule and look at your calendar for the fall and sign up to join us in Bible study. You can find that information on our What's Happening page. Next, I want to let you know about something coming up for our S2 or our Sojourn Students Ministry. If you are the parent of a middle or high schooler, or if you are a middle or high schooler, this one's for you. Next Sunday, we'll be doing our S2 kickoff, and this starts with water slides, snow cones, all kinds of fun on the lawn next week. Middle school will gather from 4 to 6, and then our high schoolers from 6:30 to 8:30. So we hope that you'll make plans to attend that evening. It's going to be a lot of fun. Great way to kick off a semester of fun with S2. Also want to let you know, parents of those kids, we're going to be having a parent meeting next Sunday morning in between the services, right in the room at the back of the auditorium. This is a chance for you to get to know our S2 leaders, kind of find out their vision and their goals for this semester of that ministry, and also ask any questions you might have. So if you are middle school, high school family, that's for you, and we hope that you'll join us. Finally, I wanted to let you know that today with us, we have the Rogers family. And Jeff and Vicki Rogers are missionaries to the Dominican Republic. They're sent out from East, and they've been doing really important work in the Dominican Republic for several years. But they're here with us today. They'll be in the atrium after the service, and they would love to share with you what's going on in their ministry and their work there in the DR. And they'd also just love for you to come by and say hello. So stop by the atrium after the service and say hello to the Rogers. As always, you can find out everything that's going on here. Find those registration links, all that stuff on our What's Happening page, sojourneast.com/what's happening. As we come to our time of giving, this marks a rhythm in our week where we pause to think about the way that we can fuel the mission of the church and what God is doing here by giving of our time and our money. Those of you who've pledged your membership and you're calling this church your home, this call is for you. You've committed to move forward what God is doing here. If you are visiting with us today, we hope that this service is a gift to you. And our scripture this morning comes from Exodus 16, 1 through 5, and 27 through 31. So if you're able, please stand for the reading of God's word. The whole Israelite community set out from Elam and came to the desert of Sin, which is between Elam and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had come out of Egypt. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into the desert to starve this entire assembly to death." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on the other days. 6 days you are to gather it, but on the seventh day, the Sabbath, there will not be any." Nevertheless, some of the people went out on the seventh day to gather it, but they found none. Then the Lord said to Moses, "How long will you refuse to keep my commands and my instructions? Bear in mind that the Lord has given you the Sabbath. That is why on the sixth day he gives you bread for 2 days. Everyone is to stay where they are on the seventh day. No one is to go out." So the people rested on the seventh day. The people of Israel called the bread manna. It was white like coriander seed and tasted like wafers made with honey. This is the word of the Lord. You can be seated.
Well, good morning. Peace be with you. If you're visiting with us today, my name's Kevin, and I want to thank you for being here. We hope that this service really is an encouragement and blessing to you. Before we get into today's text, I'd like to invite you to pray with me. God, you have provided us with everything, with life, with breath. You haven't left us on this world alone. You've given us your word to help guide our steps and shape our hearts. I pray for us this morning as we come to this very famous passage, that your spirit would bring it to bear on our lives in a way that would shape us, shape how we see you, see ourselves, see the world and our place in it. We ask all of this in the name of your son. Amen. In 2007, my wife and I were part of a small group of people that planted a church in Middletown, Ohio. It's called the Oaks Community Church. And we were like mid to late 20s, and we were the old geezers of the church. It was a very, very young church, which means we were very poor, but we had a lot of free time and a lot of energy. And we were looking for a place to meet. And in downtown Middletown, this is in Ohio again, there is an old opera house that was built like 100 years ago. And in its heyday, it had to be one of the coolest venues you could ever walk into. But over a matter of, you know, decades of neglect, it had fallen into quite disrepair. So it was beautiful, but it was kind of run down. And so if you were an optimist, you'd walk in and you would just think, look at the potential of what this could be. If you were a pessimist, you would think this is a huge liability, like for our church to meet here. Like, there's going to be lawsuits within a couple of months. The guys who ran it, they were, we'll just say they were a little shady, but they gave us a good deal. And so We met there for 3 or 4 weeks, and then the second week of October, we show up for Sunday worship in the atrium, kind of the welcome area that everyone has to walk through to come to the service, had completely been transformed by these owners who on a whim decided to turn it into a haunted opera house. And it wasn't just like, oh, there's some spider webs or even maybe a skeleton. I mean, there was like really like the most intense, revolting Halloween kind of imagery you could imagine, including pentagrams on the floor, satanic imagery, demonic imagery, which when you're a young church plant trying to establish, hey, we're not weird, we're certainly not a cult, we're trustworthy, it's not a great look. And so we're like, we have got to get out of here like by next week. And so we searched through downtown trying to find a place to meet. We found one spot that would meet our needs. The only problem was they didn't have any chairs. And to get enough chairs, we'd need about 200 chairs. Chairs are about $50 a piece. So we needed $10,000 fast. And we were broke. Like, we didn't have two nickels to rub together. $10,000 might as well have been $10 million to us. It wasn't like, well, we can make this work. It's like, we do not have access to that kind of money. So the next Sunday, which was our last Sunday at the Opera House, I got up and I said, hey, we're going to be moving for a lot of reasons. Everyone knew why we were moving. And I said, but we don't have any chairs in our new meeting space. And so we're going to, like, if you have a camping chair, you know, lawn chair, whatever, we're just going to try to make it work. We'll bring them. It's not going to look the best. But or if you're willing, would you consider buying your own chair or a chair for your family, $50 a piece? Not knowing how people would respond afterwards, a couple who was visiting that Sunday, it was their first Sunday ever visiting this church, meeting in a haunted satanic opera house, they came up afterwards and they handed me a check and they said, hey, we'd like to help out with the chairs. And I said, thanks. And I set the check aside and I was talking with people. And after everyone cleared out that morning, I remembered, oh, we did get one donation. I thought maybe they're going to buy like the first chair, which would be something to celebrate. And I'll never forget opening the check, and it was for $10,000. I had never seen that many zeros on a check in my life. That is not an exaggeration. I mean, I opened it up, and my hands started shaking. Like, is this real? And I called my executive pastor then, who's also the executive pastor here now, Brian. Brian came in, and he's looking at it, I think this is valid. Like, and it was incredible. That night, we had a party with the core group. And I mean, we were all just stunned and dumbfounded. And then one of my friends, because we were like, this is just so unbelievable. One of my friends there finally spoke up. And I'll never forget this moment. He said, why are you surprised? Why did this surprise you? Like, our God owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. He's called us to plant this church. Why is it a shock that he would come through when we needed chairs? And it was this, we're good friends, so it was a stinging indictment, but you know, faithful are the wounds of a friend, of like, man, what a way to look at the world. And why don't I look at the world like that more often? I'm convinced one of the great challenges of the Christian life is simply believing what the Bible says is true. Believing what the Bible says about who our God is, his character, his nature, his relationship, and love for us. Believing that it's actually true. Today's text is a great illustration of that. We're picking up today kind of where we left off last week. If you weren't here last week, that's fine. The Israelites have been delivered from their slavery in Egypt. And God, because he cares about them and he cares about not just what they believe, but the kind of people they're becoming, God starts to put them through some tests. And he actually told them that in the passage we looked at last week. And his goal in these tests is to deepen them, to grow them in their trust for him. And so they went a few days without water. That was the first test. Today we're looking at the second test, where they're going some days without food. And as is fairly predictable for the Israelites, they go a few days without food, the hunger pangs start to pierce their side, and the people start not to pray, but to grumble. And they don't grumble against God, but just like they did at Marah, they grumble once again against Moses. Which, when you keep this in context, it's pretty stunning. God said, hey, I'm going to put you through some tests. I'm going to stretch you. They find themselves in a test. They apparently forgot that God gave them that warning. And really, it seems like they forgot God altogether. Because there's no mention of them praying to God here, or clinging to his promises, or trusting and encouraging one another. God is good. He's testing us. We're going to rely on his goodness. There is none of that. Instead, there is this weird nostalgia. If only we would be back in Egypt and died there where we sat around pots of meat, which they never did in Egypt. It's like this false remembering. And this will be the Israelites' most persistent problem in the wilderness years, is while they would say they believed in God, functionally they were atheists. When trials came, when hardships came, when they found themselves in need, they didn't cry out to him, they didn't trust in him, they didn't have even awareness that God's eyes were on them and he would take care of them. And so they grumble. And God in his kindness, he doesn't strike them down for grumbling a week after. You know, he just rebuked them for grumbling. Instead, he tells Moses in verse 4, I will rain down. This is what's going to happen. I'm going to rain down bread from heaven for you. And the people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. And this way I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on the other days. God says there's two rules to this bread I'm going to provide. Number one, take what you need, no more. And number two, take twice what you need on the sixth day, because on the seventh you're not going to gather. And this is going to be, God is saying, this is going to be me demonstrating my goodness and my presence to you. And so the Israelites who were living as functional atheists, Moses and Aaron call them all into a meeting. And I want to read this. It's four or five verses, but I want to read it because I want you to see if there's any themes that stick out to you from what Moses and Aaron say to the Israelites who have completely lost sight of the Lord and his presence and his goodness. Moses and Aaron said to the Israelites, "In the evening, you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. And in the morning you will see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard you grumbling against him. Who are we that you should grumble against us?" Moses also said, "You will know that it's..." Are you noticing some repetition here? "You will know that it was the Lord when he gives you meat to eat in the evening and all the bread you want in the morning, because he has heard your grumbling against him. Who are we? You are not grumbling against us, people. You're grumbling against the Lord." Then Moses told Aaron, "Say to the entire Israelite community, come before the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling." And while Aaron was speaking to the whole Israelite community, they looked towards the desert, and there was the glory of the Lord appearing in the cloud. So these people who have this spiritual amnesia, Moses and Aaron are like, all right, let's go back. God delivered us. God has provided for us. God is with us. And then guess who shows up? God in the cloud. That night, God provides quail, and the people feast on quail. The next morning, they wake up, and the ground is covered in bread from heaven. And this isn't bread as we kind of think of it. It was a white, sticky substance, kind of flaky, that would cover the ground, that was sweet to the taste. And when the people saw it, they didn't even know exactly what it is. That they asked, like, what is this? Which, that question in Hebrew sounds very much like manna. And that's where it got its name. They're like, what is this stuff? And so they see it, and Moses is like, okay, we've talked about this, but let me reiterate. There's one rule for you today. Just take what you need. Don't take more than you need. Don't, like, store it up. Just take what you need. But we're told in verse 20 that some of them paid no attention to Moses. They kept part of it until morning, but it was full of maggots and began to smell. So Moses was angry with them. Like, he had one job, people. A few days pass. They get to the sixth day. And the sixth day, Moses calls them together and says, all right, we have the second and final rule. Today, actually, go gather twice as much. And then tomorrow, on the seventh day, I don't want you to gather anything at all. And yet, nevertheless, some of the people went out on the seventh day to gather it, but they found none. Then the Lord said to Moses, how long will you refuse my commands and my instructions? Now, I think there's a simplistic way of reading this that God seems kind of petty here. Like, this is what you're upset about? I mean, when we think about all of the horrible things human beings do in this world, do to each other, this is the one that God is going to dwell on. Is he being petty? But he's not being petty. He's a father, and he's trying to teach his kids the most valuable lesson they'll ever learn, and they refuse to listen to him. And so he gets frustrated. You know, if you're a parent, if you've been around little kids, you know that there's just something in the human heart that it's like you can hear it, you can hear the instruction, and then not do it. It's like telling your kid, please do not lick the doorknob. Right? It's not good for you. It's not good for other people. Just don't do it. And there's something within your child, though, after you tell them that doorknob starts looking like a popsicle. You know, like, maybe I should lick that. What is that? Well, on one level, it's sin. It's rebellion. It's no one's going to tell me what to do. But I think even underneath that, it's the child doesn't actually trust you enough in that point. That actually you don't want all of the germs of everyone who's touched that. That would be bad for your body. In the same way, these Israelites, when they break these very simple rules, it's not just their behavior, it's their heart's posture. It's a lack of trust in who God is and his provision. And God, everything he's doing in the wilderness, he's trying to train them in a new way of seeing the world and living in the world that's going to be radically different than the ways of Egypt. See, this story, it really does. It presents two opposing ways of seeing the world and understanding your place in it. Two stories. The first story we could call the story of self-sufficiency. In this story, this way of seeing the world, as you look out and this earth, it is a battleground that can be brutal and there are limited resources. And you have to get and accomplish and achieve and acquire all that you can, or else you're going to starve. And this story of self-sufficiency, it's either eat or get eaten. And so you fight and you claw and you scrape. You better look out for number one, because no one else is looking out for you. You are the main character of your story, and everything is riding on you. And so you better perform, you better keep up, you better always be on your guard, you got to have eyes on the back of your head, always constantly evaluating the threats on the horizon, because it's all riding on you. In this story, or this is the story that's fueled almost all of the wars throughout human history, like there's only so much, we got to take what's ours. It also fuels most conflicts even today, even interpersonally. Because if this is how you see the world, when you see other people, you see them as either obstacles, competition, or maybe even vehicles. Like, how could I use them to get what I need and what I want? I think this way of seeing the world and living in the world, it does violence, not just to other people, it does violence to our own souls. That's why we're exhausted, why we're paralyzed so much with anxiety and fear, because you live just with this feeling, I have to get this done, I have to achieve, I have to perform. I feel the pressure, because if I don't do this, bad things are going to happen. And so I'm just going to keep climbing the ladder, because it's there and the rungs keep going up, and I'm just going to keep going after. You're constantly living on edge. I think this is why so many people struggle to sleep at night. Because how can you sleep if everything's hanging on you? And if your entire life, like if your life is busy like mine, like most of ours, you're always juggling responsibilities all over the place, and you forget things. You said you're going to do something and you didn't, and you remember that when you're laying in bed. And so you can't sleep because you're thinking, what's going to happen? And then I drop that ball, and then what are the consequences of that? And so we live stressed out all the time. We eat fast food that we know is horrible for us, but it's like I need fuel to keep up because all of the demands are riding on me. And then we live with this perpetual low-grade guilt of all of the things that we didn't do, we didn't get done. All of the ways we haven't been the best employee or husband or mom or dad. And life ends up feeling like this tightrope strung across Niagara Falls. And we're wearing these like heavy backpacks. And you can't stay still. You got to keep moving forward. But you live feeling like, man, if I make a wrong step, I'm going to plummet to my doom. And everything is going to fall apart. Now, if that's how you see the world, and you wake up one morning and you see manna covering the ground, you're probably going to go grab all that you can, right? Like you're going to empty out, you know, your dresser drawers. You're going to grab your buckets from your garage, whatever you can. And you're going to gather as much manna because it's all out here. And it's eat or be eaten. So I'm going to take it all. And, you know, the enterprising among us would say, you know, might be able to sell this to the people who overslept. People with bad knees, bad backs, you know, I'll cut them a discount. But I could provide a service for them here. On the Sabbath, even if the Lord told you not to go get it, you're smart. Like you've lived in this world long enough, you're not naive. You know someone's going to go out there and get it. Someone's going to get ahead. And so why not be you? That's one story. God wants his people to live in a radically different kind of story. Story of creaturely dependence. And in this story, the world is not a cold and brutal battleground. The world is God's good creation. Now, make no mistake, sin has entered the world. People do horrible things. It's fallen, bad things. It's not if they're going to happen to us. They will eventually. But in this story, we recognize that even when the bad things happen, God is still good. And that God is ruling over everything down to the finest details of our lives, even the number of hairs on our head. In this story, we recognize that everything we have is a gift, that God is the giver of all good things, that our bodies are gifts, that a breath is a gift, that bread is a gift. And it all comes from our Father who's good. And he rules over all, which means we don't have to rule over all. Like he bears responsibility for the weight of the world, so we don't have to. And he looks after us like a good father or mother looks after their children. He actually anticipates their needs. And he meets them. Now, if you're living in that story, and then your father said, hey, I just want you to take what you need for today. Don't take more. You wake up the next morning, you see manna everywhere, and you know that's who your father is. You're probably just going to go out and take what you need. You know, you'll eyeball it. You're like, well, this kid doesn't eat that much. This kid's eating a ton. Puberty does it. You know, like, and you're like getting the math, and you're like, all right, I think I need about this amount of manna, and that's all. And there's all this other manna out there, and you're like, I don't need it. Someone else can have it. I've got what I need. And on the Sabbath, when the Lord said, this day don't go out, I just want you to rest. I want you to worship me and enjoy the life I've given you. On the Sabbath, you'd be like, well, we got enough for today, and I'm confident that there'll be more tomorrow. See, in this story of creaturely dependence, you live with a profound trust in the goodness of God and the provision of God. when you prayed, you wouldn't be praying for like millions of dollars, because a lot of times that's just, when we think about like millions of dollars or winning the lottery, what we're saying is, I don't want to have to trust anyone, including God, ever again. I want enough money that I can do whatever I want all the time and not have to live in a state of dependence. But if you're living into this story of creaturely dependence, you're like, I just need daily bread, Lord. Hungry. Living in this story, you probably wouldn't worry so much. You'd look around, you'd remember the words of Jesus, so you'd see the flowers, and it's like, oh yeah, God provides for them. You'd see the birds, oh, they don't go hungry. You'd live in a place of trust. You'd probably sleep better at night, knowing that you don't have to keep watch because God is keeping watch. You'd probably say no to a whole lot more things than you currently do, because you'd actually be able to embrace your limits. Like, I am not God. I cannot do everything. Here's what's been entrusted to me, so I'm going to be faithful here. Which to you is the better story? Like, which story do you want to live into? Now, because one of the gifts of pastoring a place for a long time is I already know the objections. I already know the whatabouts that people are already thinking. So let's just tackle two of them. The first one is, well, what about personal responsibility? Are you saying we're not responsible for our lives or we shouldn't work? No way. The Israelites, they had to get up and gather every single day except for on the Sabbath. They weren't, you know, like in the movie WALL-E, God didn't throw them in recliners and then just put a feeding tube of manna and they're just kind of like staring at the screen. No, like, He gave them a task. He gave them responsibility. And he expected them to go do it. And if they didn't go gather, they wouldn't eat. But they knew that even though they had to gather, they knew everything they gathered was a gift. And so they would gather, but they recognized, but this is from God. In the same way, understanding that we are dependent creatures doesn't mean we sit back in life, doesn't mean we hit autopilot. Instead, it leads us to recognize that what we have, God has given to us to steward well. And so we want to steward it well, but we never lose sight of the fact that we're stewards. And the day is coming when all of us are going to die and we're going to leave it behind. So we want to carry the responsibilities well. That's one objection. The other objection is, well, this creaturely dependence, does that undermine human ambition? And I would say, no way. But it absolutely undermines selfish ambition. And Paul is very clear, Philippians 2:3, do nothing out of selfish ambition. God is not saying here, I don't want you to be ambitious, to look, to dream, to build, to do good. He's not saying, I don't want you to care for the world or your neighbor, love and serve them, love and serve me, or do good in the world. In no way. Ambition is good. But selfish ambition, which is done in service of making your own name great, making people think well of you, of building your reputation, or building a huge bank account just for the sake of having it, biblically, that should be examined. Because it's not just about the bank account or the reputation. It's really about, like, where are you fundamentally putting your trust? Now, we live in a different day. The Israelites, they only had the manna for a season. And so we do have to be careful about making some one-to-one correlations here. That they didn't get to collect manna every day. But God was training them and he was teaching them. He's saying, this is going to be a fundamental story. Actually, at the end of the story, God says, I want you to collect some of this manna and you're going to put it in the temple where it's going to remain forever, because I want you to never forget this story. I want you to never forget that I provided you with your daily bread. You know, our mission here at Sojourn East is to guide people into the fullness of life that Jesus offers. And that comes from John 10:10, where Jesus said, the thieves come to steal, kill, and destroy, but I've come that you have life and life to the full, life in abundance, life overflowing. We've been captivated by this vision that the Christian life extends, it's not less than, but extends well beyond believing certain things, praying certain prayers, raising your hand, and having certainty or assurances about the future. That when Jesus calls us into life with him, he cares about our lives here and now, about who we are, about who we're becoming. I mean, you read the Sermon on the Mount, he cares about whether or not we're ruled by fear or doubt or anger or greed. And I think the greatest witness that we can offer to the world is to be the kind of people who live into a radically different story than the world lives in. Doesn't mean we have to be naive. Doesn't mean we check all of life lessons at the doors. But could you imagine being around a group of people who the baseline of their anxiety was just significantly lower than the world around them? And the like grabbing and seizing and competition, it just, it wasn't there in the same way. And they slept really well. And they lived from a place of profound trust. Well, how can we take some steps in that direction? Well, there are a lot of things we can do. God's given us a lot of means of grace, a lot of ways to grow. One is we can read his word, which is essential. We can pray, essential. But what I find so intriguing about this text is it's almost as if God knew that this inhabiting this story would be so challenging and so countercultural and counterintuitive that God actually went so far as to reshape their entire understanding of time to help them. He's like, this isn't like something like you, I'm going to have to build this into your rhythm of life. And so 6 days you're going to work, and on the seventh you're going to rest. And this is going to keep your days from just bleeding into each other. You got to imagine in the desert, you don't have clocks, you don't have calendars. You know, you're out there. The days would just kind of all blend into one, kind of like it does in our lives when you hit busy seasons. I'm sure I'm not the only one that you like look at the calendar and you're like, it's August 20th today? Where did the last 4 weeks or 4 months go? How did we get here? And God says, I want to retrain how you think about time. And I want you to enter into a rhythm where 6 days you work, on the seventh day you rest. And this seventh day, it's a command, but it's also a gift. Verse 29, God doesn't say to them, bear in mind that the Lord has commanded you to Sabbath. He says, bear in mind that the Lord has given you the Sabbath. It's a gift. That one out of every 7 days, I want you to do nothing, God says, but enjoy me and the life I've given you. Now, the first time I taught on Sabbath, it's probably 10 years ago, and I was a younger preacher. I probably overstated some things, so I'm going to own that up front. I was a little more fiery back then. But I was really taken aback by how much resistance came my way from that sermon. You know, there was probably two sides of the same coin, but there were some people who were really anxious about it, like, well, do we have to do Sabbath? Am I disobeying God if I don't? What is Sabbath? Is it 24 hours a day? Which day is it? What defines work? Like, all of the rules. And then there are other people who are just angry. How dare you tell me I can't work all of the time without stopping? Aren't we living in the freedom of Christ? Shouldn't I have the freedom to do that if I want to? This is legalism. Didn't Jesus work on the Sabbath? And I think there's some legitimacy in that objection, and really in both. It's really easy to become legalistic when we think about the Sabbath. That's what the Pharisees did. They created 1,521 rules of activities and other things you were not allowed to do on the Sabbath. And what they did is they turned this great gift God gave into a law. And Jesus, some of my favorite stories in the Gospels is Jesus, he knows the 1,521 things that you're not allowed to do. And so he's with his disciples and he'll just do it. It's like, oh, we're not allowed to pluck the head of grain like this. And then he just eats it. And it enraged them. Oh, we're not allowed to do work and helping someone who's hurting. That's work. Well, watch what I'm about to do. And so it comes to this head. There's a great conflict where they're like, you claim you're from God, you claim you're holy, and you're breaking these things. And then Jesus, he offers the definitive line on Sabbath in Mark 2. He says, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for Sabbath. And Jesus does two really important things here. One, he tramples on and dismantles their legalistic man-made regulations about the Sabbath. He's like, no, that's, you're missing the point. But at the same time, he does affirm that it was a gift that God gave to humanity. God is saying, I want you, one day out of every seven, to stop, to rest, to remember that this life is a gift, everything you have is a gift, and that I'm in control. Remember your creatureliness. I think for Christians, it takes on an even new meaning, because so much of our work is driven by our insecurity. And as Christians, we know that we have been saved by the grace of God. And Sabbathing is a way for us to actually rest, not just from our labors, but to rest in the finished work of God. To remember that we were saved single-handedly, not because of something we did, but because God is so good and so kind. Hebrews 4:3 actually says that those who have believed in Christ have already entered into the rest of God. It's a grace. And Dan Allender, he provocatively says this, that the Sabbath is routinely rejected because it is one of our most profound tastes of grace. You get what he's saying there? It's like, it's so good. Like, are you kidding me? One day a week, before the face of God, I can lay my work down and just enjoy my life and enjoy God and enjoy what he's given me and not feel guilty about it. It's like there's something in us, no, that doesn't seem right. I need to feel anxious all the time and guilty and just keep going and go. We reject the grace. So I want to put a challenge before you. Call it the Sabbath challenge. I recognize we're in different seasons of life. Last thing I'm doing is giving you a law. Some of you, if you're in school, certainly if you're like in med school, you're like that. You might have to adapt some things, and that's fine. But I want to encourage you to actually really thoughtfully consider, where are you going in life? What space have you created in life to remind yourself that you are a creature and you are dependent upon God and his mercy and his grace? So, three steps to this challenge. Number one, plan and pray, or pray and plan. Like, you don't stumble into living a life of rhythm of work and rest. It doesn't just like, yeah, I don't know, it just happened one day. Like, you actually sit down and you say, this day is a day. And if you can't do a whole day, this 4-hour block. Plan and pray, step one. Step two, this is really hard, stop working. Like, during that time, stop working. What is work? Well, if you have to ask, if you're a workaholic and you're asking, is this work? Yes. Like, some of you, you might be on the other end, but just knowing our church, like, we've got probably forever, like, one person who doesn't work very hard. We probably have 9 people who lean towards the workaholism. So that's who I'm speaking to here. If you don't work hard, work hard. All right. But stop working. Like, rest. Put your phone down. So plan and pray. Stop working. And then you're going to have this void in your life. And then in that void, this is the third step. Enjoy God and the life he has given you. Enjoy God and the life he's given you. You could read the word, and you can do it in an unhurried way because you don't have anything else to do. If it's on a Sunday, you can come to church. And hopefully, because you know that day is set aside, like, you can really just immerse yourself in some of the words that we sing and we pray. There's a book that's really stirring your affections for God. You can sit with that. Enjoy God. But I would also say enjoy the life God has given you. Go for a walk or a hike or take a kayak out on Floyd's Fork. Listen to music that you love. Cook a great meal and say grace and mean it before the meal. God, thank you. Thank you for our daily bread. Maybe light a candle at that dinner just as a visible reminder that God is present there. do things on that day to remember that we live in a great story. And this other story, it's a horrible, oppressive story, but that we don't have to live there. We can actually live trusting that God is good. He provides for our every need, and he actually encourages us to live like this. And when you do that, I bet your stress level will go down. You might see your blood pressure go down, but your trust level in God, I guarantee, will grow, because it's not just about that day. Doing that in that day enables you for the next 6 days to enter into the world in that better story that, yes, we are creatures, but we are loved. We are fallen and redeemed. We are limited, and yet God is for us. So I want to encourage you to do it. I want to encourage you to really consider doing it. And then if you come back and you're like, I did this for 6 months and it was a total waste of time, I would love to hear from you. I really would. As we move to the Lord's table, what a great reminder to us that all that we have is a gift and that our God is eager to provide. The night Jesus betrayed, you know, his disciples, it wasn't their best moment. They're gonna deny him, abandon him. One will betray him. He takes a loaf of bread and he breaks it and he says, this is my body that's broken for you. And then he takes the cup and he says, this is the cup of the new covenant of my blood that's poured out for you. And he says, do this in remembrance of me. When we come to take communion, we come with empty hands, right? We come, we bring our sin, our worries, our stresses, our doubts, our unbelief. But we come with empty hands, and then we come forward and we tear off the bread and dip it in either the wine or the juice. And in doing so, we realize like the gift nature, not just of our life, but our salvation. That God's love for us is not dependent upon what we do, because while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So if you're here this morning and you have sin you need to confess, it's kind of eating away at you, I encourage you to do that before you come to the table. If your heart feels far from God, I encourage you to come to the table and be reminded of his presence and his goodness. If you're here and you're not a Christian, we would ask that you not take part in this meal, and that's not because we want to exclude you. We really want you to take part in this meal, but we don't want you to have the experience and miss the meaning. This is a meal for those who have put their hope and their trust in Christ and who feed on him. And so if you haven't done that, we would invite you to do that. Would you pray with me? Father, you are good and you are faithful. And sometimes life in this fallen world, whether it's our sin, the sin of others, or just brokenness, it's easy for us to lose sight of that, for that truth to become obscured, but that truth is unchanging. And so I pray, Lord, that we would be a people who would strive to live into that story and live out of that story. I pray that we would work hard and do great things in this world, but we would do it from a place of being centered in your love and your mercy, and in that way we truly would be a light in a dark, dark world. Lord, your mercy, it overwhelms us when we see our sin, when we see how quick we are to forget. I pray that you would comfort us, that you would draw us near, that you would strengthen us and send us out. We ask these things in Christ's name.
You're the God of covenant and faithful promises. And time again, You have proven you'll do just what you say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I remain steadfast. And let my heart learn when you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me.
Sing if he's been faithful to you.
Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me.
God, from age to age, though the earth may pass away, your word remains the same. Your history can prove there's nothing you can't do. You're faithful and true. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I remain steadfast. And let my heart learn when you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to
setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness.
Praise him for his faithfulness. Amen. Well, church family, twice a year, the worship ministry hosts a night of auditions for the band and for the praise team. And so if you're musically talented and looking for a way to serve our church, I want to take this moment to encourage you to sign up. This worship ministry seeks to serve all of you every week with consistency, with humility, and with excellence. And so if this sounds like something you would like to be a part of, the auditions will be on September 6th at 6:30 p.m. You can register on our website on the What's Happening page. and we hope to see you there. Every time we gather, we end our services with a benediction, which is a blessing spoken over you as you go. If you'd like to receive this blessing, I want to invite you to open your arms with us. Church family, go now reminded that every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Go now in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.